Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. But what does it mean for our lives? I want to read this morning from Ephesians, the third chapter. I'm going to read from the middle of verse 17 through verse 20. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Ephesians, writes, "And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all that we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen." I want to submit to you this morning that the most important thing that you believe in life is what you believe about God, because it affects every other area of your life. It affects how you deal with your past. It affects how you face the future. It affects how you live your life today. What you believe about God affects every area of your life. But unfortunately, there are a lot of things that can distort our view of God. Our background can distort our view of God. The media can distort our view of God. Painful experiences can distort our view of God. What other people tell us about God, our own insecurities, even our own sins can distort our view of God. The result is most people have an inaccurate view of God. Some people think that God is like an impersonal force, like Star Wars, "Let the Force be with you." There's a power there, but it's impersonal and it's distant. Other people think God is like a judgmental, unpleasable parent, always criticizing, always finding fault. Some people think of God as a cruel tyrant. Other people think of God like Santa Claus. Now, the problem with this is that when you don't understand what God is really like, you fall into one of two mistakes. You either deny him because you just can't believe the picture of God that you have. That's why whenever people tell me, "Well, I don't believe in God," I always ask them, "Well, what kind of God don't you believe in?" Because I may not believe in that kind of God either. People say, "Well, I don't believe in a God who does this and this and this." And I can often say, "Well, I don't either. I don't feel like I have to defend a God that's not a God like the God who's presented to us in the Bible." People say also, sometimes when we don't deny God, we just like to and can't accept the God that's been presented to us. We just make up a God of our own. People, you know, say all the time things like, "Well, I don't believe in a God who does this and this and this." Well, or they say, "I like to think of a God as." I want to suggest to you this morning, respectfully, that it doesn't really matter what my opinion about God is or what your opinion about God is. The question is, what is God really like? God is the ultimate source of our being. He's the ultimate source of truth. If you don't have a true understanding of God, it's ultimately going to collapse and everything's going to fall in. So what does God say about himself? That's why on this Easter Sunday, I want to talk about God, the God that Jesus Christ came to reveal to us. Because I think the only way that you're going to have any sense of peace, any sense of joy, any sense of stability in the rapidly changing world that we live in today is if you know the God who created you to love you, who died on a cross and was resurrected as we celebrate today. Now, most of you have seen the bumper sticker, "God loves you." It's a nice thought, but how do I know it's true? How do I know God really loves me? How do I know God cares about me? Well, the answer is God has proven that he cares about you in many, many ways. Today, I just want to talk about three of those ways. How does God demonstrate how much he cares about us? Well, first of all, God cares enough about you to reveal himself. The only way that human beings could even know that there was a God is if God chose to let us know that he was out there. if God chooses to reveal himself in ways we can understand, if God didn't choose to let us know about him, none of us would have any idea there was any such thing as a God. You see, as human beings, we live in three dimensions. We now know from quantum physics that there are at least 10 dimensions for the world to be the way that it is. And God exists outside of time and space. So God exists in at least 11 dimensions. If a three-dimensional human being, I mean, how could we possibly understand a God that lives in at least 11 dimensions? It's like a microbe in a drop of pond water trying to understand the existence and the nature of a human being that's looking at it through a microscope. The microbe has no idea it's being watched, and even if it did it, it wouldn't have any way of understanding the complexity and the real nature of the human being watching it. Our brain capacity, our powers of conception, they're too limited to understand the nature of God unless God takes the initiative of trying to show us that he exists in ways we can understand. Fortunately, God does want us to know that he exists, and he gives us some clues to let us know what he's like. One way that we know something about God is through creation, through nature. By looking at the universe, we can know that God is organized. There's system, order, design, symmetry, the way the planets revolve around the stars, the way our human body is put together, composed of amazingly complex systems of systems, carefully balanced like the ecosystems that we see all around us in the world. We know by looking at the universe around us that God is tremendously powerful because of the immense forces it took to hurl the stars into space. There's tremendous power in the ocean, in the winds, even in an individual atom. We know by looking at the world around us that God likes variety. There wouldn't have to be thousands of different kinds of flowers and hundreds of different color combinations, all the smells, all the tastes, all the textures that are around us. The world could be black and white. It could be smooth. We know that God loves beauty. Look at a sunset or the stars at night or the beautiful fields and flowers that we see, rainbows. And God gave us eyes to see all of that. We know how God has a sense of humor. When you look at what he's created, orangutans and giraffes and camels, or look at yourself in the morning before you comb your hair and before you have your first cup of coffee, God has a sense of humor. But the most important thing that you need to know about God, the most important things you need to know, you can't know just by looking at nature. If all you know about God are the clues that he leaves us in nature, you're going to have a very limited and skewed understanding of God. But God gives us more than nature to know him. 2,000 years ago, God came to earth in human form so that humans could understand him. If I wanted to really communicate with ants, the best way would be to become an ant. I can't do that, but God can. And God came into this world as a human being we know as Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, the God-man. Jesus Christ is the focal point of history. The whole calendar is divided based on if something occurred before Jesus lived or after his coming to this earth. Today, Jesus has been on the cover of Life and Newsweek and Time more than any other person in history. Why is there such tremendous interest in a person who lived 2,000 years ago? Why are they still making movies about him? Because God's coming into time and history made a huge difference. Luke 2:32 says, Jesus is a light to reveal God to the nations. Jesus came into the world to show us the true nature of God. Colossians 1:15 says that Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. Jesus says the same thing about himself in John 14:9. Jesus says, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. Now that's a pretty audacious statement. If you think about it, Jesus is saying, I'm God. Jesus says he's the only way to heaven. In John 14:6, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus says he's the door to God. He's the water of life. That's why you can't say Jesus was just a good man. He was either one of the biggest liars who's ever lived, or he was who he said he was. Was Jesus telling the truth when he said that if you've seen me, you've seen the Father? Was Jesus telling the truth that, you know, that he is the way to God, the only way to God? The greatest question that you're going to have to determine into your life is, what do you believe about Jesus Christ? Was he really who he said he was, or is it just all a fraud? People today want to take a middle ground with Jesus. They say, oh, he was a great teacher. He was a good man. He was a prophet. Well, a good man or a great prophet wouldn't claim to be God and deceive millions of people, many of whom died throughout the ages because they believed what he said. They died a martyr's death. Now, if I stood here this morning and said, well, my name is Alan Stanford, and I try to teach people how to have a better, richer, more meaningful life, most of you would say, well, I guess I can buy that. But if I said, hi, my name is Alan Stanford, and I'm God, well, you shouldn't accept that. Most of you wouldn't accept that. But you have to decide then, is he crazy or is he crazy and dangerous? Because you just can't ignore statements like that. How do I know Jesus Christ was God and not a crazy man or a fraud? Because Jesus said, I'm going to prove it. I'm going to prove it by dying for the sins of the world. And 3 days later, I'm going to come back to life to prove that everything that I've said is true. And that's exactly what he did. That's why over 2 billion people on this planet will celebrate Easter this weekend. That's why all of history is divided by this one event. Jesus came back and he walked the streets of Jerusalem, and so many people saw him at one appearance. Over 500 people saw him at the same time in the same place, and the news spread like wildfire around the world. That's why people are gathered in churches all around this world this weekend, because Jesus proved that he was who he said he was. So the question is, what do we know about God now because of Jesus Christ? Well, we know that God made us for a purpose, that we're not an accident. In Ephesians 2:10, for you are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which God prepared in advance for you to do. We know that God has a plan for your life. Through his prophet, he said, you know, I know the plans I have for you, plans for good and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. We know that God loves you so much that he came into this world and died on a cross for your sins, that he wants to forgive us, not to condemn us. We know that God wants to have a relationship with you, and that's not just a back burner issue. That's at the heart of everything God has done and is doing. God cared enough about you to reveal himself through Jesus Christ because he wanted you to know what he was really like and how much he loves you. But not only does God love you enough to reveal himself to you, God cares enough about you and me to rescue us. God's love is this amazing love. Jesus often told stories to teach truths about God. Once Jesus told 3 stories in a row with exactly the same point. In rapid fire in Luke 15, Jesus makes the same point in 3 different ways. The first story Jesus tells is about a man who has 100 sheep. One of them wanders off, so he leaves the 99 in the sheepfold, and he goes and searches high and low until he finds the lost sheep, and he brings it home safely. And the Bible says he calls all of his friends together, and they have a party because this one lost sheep is found. Then Jesus tells a story about a woman who lost a coin. She had 10 coins. She loses one. She turns the house upside down until she finds it. She's so excited, she calls all of her friends and neighbors and has a party. Then Jesus tells a third story about a man who has 2 sons, but one of those sons demanded his inheritance and left the father and went to a far country. Now, we usually call that the story of the prodigal son. The prodigal son demanded his inheritance and took the money the father gave him. He squanders it all in a foreign country on wine, women, and song. He wastes every penny, and he ends up with nothing, having to feed pigs just for a meager wage. Jesus said he was so hungry he longed to eat what the pigs were eating. But one day he comes to his senses and he says to himself, even my servants in my father's house live better than I do. I'm going home. And on the way home, he practices his apology to the father. Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm not worthy to be your son. Take me back as one of your hired men. But when his father sees him coming down the lane, he recognizes that it's his son. And he rushes to meet him. And his son tries to get out his apology, but his father is smothering with hugs and kisses, putting the family ring on his finger, calling for the servants to bring the finest robe to cover the rags that his sons come in, and to kill the fatted calf because they're going to have a party. This son who was lost is returned to the father. So what was Jesus trying to teach in these three stories? Well, the common denominator in each of the stories is that something valuable has been lost that really mattered to the person who lost it. The point was, you matter to God and are very valuable, and whether you wandered off like the lost sheep, or stomped off like the rebellious son, or were just lost in the shuffle like the lost coin, it doesn't matter how you got lost from God or what you did while you were away. God desperately wants you back. He cares far more about you than you can possibly imagine. And that's the second way that we can know God cares about us. He not only cares enough to tell us what he's really like, God cares enough about you to rescue you. When my children were little, I don't know how many times they ran out in the road or wandered off in a crowd or leaned over a balcony rail, and I've had my heart skip a beat as I reach out just in the nick of time to rescue them. Most of the time, they never even realized they needed to be rescued. You may have never realized how many times God has rescued you and how much you need a Savior, but you do. If you didn't really need a Savior, Jesus wouldn't have come and died a cruel death on the cross to take your sins upon himself. If God wouldn't have gone to so much trouble and made the effort if it wasn't imperative that you have a Savior. Each one of us needs someone to rescue us. What does he rescue us from? Well, many things, but first, Jesus came to rescue you from the guilt of your past. I've never met any person that doesn't carry a certain amount of guilt. We've all done things we wish we hadn't done. We've all said things we wish we hadn't said. The bottom line is we've all broken God's laws. When you break man's laws, you pay man's penalty. When you break God's laws, you pay God's penalty. God is a loving God, but he's also a just God. God doesn't let people get away with murder or any of the other things we've done wrong. So all of us deserve to be punished. But the good news is Jesus took the punishment we deserve on himself on the cross. That's what Easter is all about. Galatians 1:4, the Bible says, Christ gave himself for our sins to rescue us from the penalty of our sins. God's justice demands that evil be paid for. But God's love leads him to pay the penalty himself for anyone and everyone who will accept his offer. Every sin that you have ever committed or ever will commit was paid for by Jesus Christ on the cross. If you'll just accept what he's done, that's the good news. Jesus wants to rescue us from the guilt of our past. Second, he came to rescue you from a meaningless life. In John 10:10, Jesus said, I came that you might have life and that you might have it to the full, that you have it more abundantly. Jesus came to show people how to live, really live. Most people don't live. They just exist. They're in these monotonous routines. They get up in the morning, they eat, they go off to work, you know. They live for the weekends. They live for a few weeks of vacation. They live to retire. They're retired a few years. Then they get sick and they die. Is that all life is about? No. Jesus came to rescue us from a meaningless existence and show us how to live life God's way. God made you for a purpose. And he has exciting things for you to do with your life at any age and stage. And when you get in relationship with him, you begin to discover your purpose and you begin to find your niche. And that brings joy and it brings fulfillment in your life. And you feel like I'm living a life that counts for something. The third thing Jesus came to rescue you from is the fear of death. The Bible says Jesus delivered those who have lived all their lives as slaves to the fear of death. We don't like to talk about death. We don't even like to think about death. But only a fool wouldn't prepare for something that we all know is inevitable. All of us know someday we're going to die. And for many people, that knowledge takes a lot of the joy and meaning out of everything they do in life. They know they can't take their accomplishments, their treasures with them. They don't know for sure that there's anything beyond this life. Maybe we die and that's the end. The only way not to be afraid of death is to know for sure where you're going. To know that death isn't a terrible end, but a wonderful beginning. I'm not afraid to die because I know where I'm going, and I know when I get there, there are going to be exciting things to do, and I'm going to see people that I love that have gone on before me, and there isn't going to be any more pain or sorrow or suffering or evil or death. Jesus came to rescue you from the fear of death by giving you the certainty of knowing where you're going when you die. That's what Easter is all about. Jesus Christ broke the power of death. He conquered death. He is risen. That's why Jesus says in John 11, 25 and 26, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. All of us are going to die someday, and that's going to be the end of your body. But that's not going to be the end of you, because you were created to last forever. You have a spirit that God put in you that is eternal. And the Bible says you're going to exist forever in one of two places, in heaven or in hell. And you say to me, Alan, surely you don't believe in hell. Yes, I do, because I think Jesus knows more about it than you or I know about it. And Jesus talked as much about hell as he did about heaven because he didn't want anyone to go there. That's why it was so crucial that he come and die on the cross for our sins, so that no one has to go to hell. Everyone can have their sins forgiven. You say, I don't understand all this. I don't really understand how it all works. Well, I've studied it a lifetime. I don't understand completely how it all works either. You just have to grab onto the life preserver that God's throwing you. A drowning person doesn't do an analysis on the life preserver or the lifeguard when they're drowning. They just hang on for dear life. You don't have to understand it all at first. Just grab a hold of what Christ has done for you, and then you're in a position to do a thorough study of the whole matter. I always tell people, God is self-validating. If you ask him into your life, you will know that he is real. Charles Murray was preparing for the Summer Olympics when he was a student at the University of Cincinnati. Because Charlie didn't come from a religious family, when one of his friends first started talking about God's love for him and how much God wanted to have a relationship with him, he was pretty skeptical. But he felt such tremendous stress, the stress of the Olympics coming up, the stress of training, of grades, the stress of relationships. One night as he's struggling with all of this, he calls his friend and he says, tell me again about God. Read me those verses again from the Bible that talk about God's love for me. And his friend did, and they talked for a while. Then Charlie went over to the college pool to take some practice dives. Since he was preparing for the Olympics, they'd given him a key that allowed him to get into the pool at any time, even when it was closed. And it was closed. It was late at night. All the lights were off. But the pool complex at Cincinnati has huge skylights, and Charlie felt like, I know this place like the back of my hand. I'm already in my sweats with my bathing suit under it. I'm just going to walk to the platform, take a few practice dives. So he didn't turn on any of the lights. He takes off his sweats. He climbs to the top of the 20-foot diving platform. He stretches out his arms, preparing to do his first backwards dive. And when he did that, the moon shining through those skylights caused his shadow to form the shape of a cross on the wall behind the diving platform. And as he looked at that cross, all of a sudden he felt this warm sensation that just swept across him. And he had such a sense of the reality of God and the love of God. And he was so overwhelmed, he just sat down on the diving platform. And he began to pray, and he began to say, Jesus, if you're real, like my friend talks about, I want you to come into my life. I want you to guide my life. I want to know you. I want to experience the love that my friend talks about. As he sat there in the dark praying, a janitor comes in and cuts on all the lights. Startled, Charlie stands up. He turns around to see who's come in, and as he does, he notices the pool's been drained for repairs. Charles Murray mattered to God. And Charles Murray needed a Savior both for this life and for eternity. And so do you and I. You matter to God too. Right now, many of you face crossroads kinds of decisions in your life. Some of you are trying to decide, you know, am I going to stay married or am I going to get divorced? Am I going to get married? Some of you are trying to decide, do I stay in the job that I'm in or do I move to another job? Some of you are trying to decide, what do I do with my investments? How do I provide, you know, now, you know, with everything that seems to be changing? Some of you are trying to decide, do I stay in the house where I am? Do I move closer to the children? Do I move into a retirement center? There are all kinds of major life decisions, and you need God's guidance. Living life without God is like jumping off a 50-story building. People can ask you how things are going, and you might say, well, okay, right now. But the end's not in doubt. Without Christ, sooner or later, you're going to hit the ground. You're going to be overwhelmed by life and finally destroyed by death. God brought you here this Easter because He wants to rescue you. He wants you to understand what I'm saying. He wants you to hear it. And He wants you to celebrate Easter in the ultimate way by opening your life to Christ, who died for you and was resurrected to be your Savior, who loves you so very much. God wants to be your Savior in this life and beyond this life. He wants you to know that He cares for you so much that He revealed Himself, that He cares so much for you to rescue you from the guilt of the past and meaninglessness in the present and the fear of death for the future. But the ultimate expression of how much God cares about you is God cares enough about you to relate to you. The Bible says you were made to have a relationship with God. The main reason that you're here on this earth is not to make a lot of money, retire, and die. The main reason you're here is to have a relationship with the God who created you. God made you to love you. That's amazing that God would want to have a relationship with you and me, knowing everything about us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He knew everything about us. And still He died for us. And still He wants to have a relationship with us. That's almost inconceivable. And the great tragedy in this world is each one of us has rejected that relationship in our own way. We've all said at some point in our life, God, I'm going to live my own life. I have my own plans. I dream my own dreams. I don't care what you want me to do. I don't care what you created me to do. I'm going to do what I want to do. And that breaks our relationship with God. That's why when you pray, it feels like God's a million miles away. We've burned the bridge to God by our own rebellion, and there's no way back by ourselves. But God loved you so much, He provided a way. Jesus Christ and His death on the cross, it builds the bridge back to God. He rose from the dead to prove to you that following Him really was the way to God. Jesus Christ is the bridge over troubled water. 2 Corinthians 5:19 says, "For God was in Christ reconciling the world to Himself, no longer counting men's sins against them, but blotting them out. This is the wonderful message He has given to us to tell others." When you come to God, He doesn't want to condemn you for your past sins and mistakes. He forgives us. He cares about us. He wants to comfort us. He wants to help us change. You may think that you're the most terrible person in the world, that if I knew or other people knew what you do, that they could never forgive you. But God's not like people. You may have committed what you think is the most terrible sin in the whole world, but the Bible says God still wants to have a relationship with you. You may feel like you're beyond redemption, but God still loves you. You may have committed adultery. You may have had an abortion. You may be living a sexually loose life. You may have a drug habit that's controlled your life. You may have lived as a homosexual for years. It doesn't matter to God. God still wants to have a relationship with you. There is nothing that you have done or can ever do that will cause God not to love you. He doesn't love you any less now than the day you were born. Nothing you can ever do will make him love you anymore, because he has a complete love for you right now that's not based on who you are and what you've done, but who He is and what Christ did for you on the cross. All you have to do to experience God's love as a reality in your life is to pray, God, I want you to forgive my sins. And I want to accept what Christ did for me. And I want to begin to know You and to know Your love and to live for You and let You be in the driver's seat in my life. When you do, you don't hear bells ringing. Lightning's not going to fill the skies. But the Bible says the angels in heaven will be rejoicing because another lost sheep, another precious prodigal son or daughter, has decided to come home into the loving arms of the Father. Romans 5:11 says, "Now we rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God, all because of what our Lord Jesus Christ has done in dying for our sins, making us friends of God." Wouldn't you like to be a friend of God? You can, because of Easter. My prayer for you this Easter is what Paul prayed for the people of Ephesus long ago. He says, and may you be able to feel and understand as all God's children should, how long and how wide and how deep and how high His love really is, and to experience this love for yourselves. Though it is so great that you will never see the end of it or fully know or understand it, so at last you will be filled up with God Himself. Would you join me as we go to the Lord in prayer? Father, it is a wonderful thing to celebrate this morning the resurrection of Jesus Christ. To know, Father, that because He lives, His promise is we shall live also. To know that You love us, not because of who we are and what we've done, but because of who You are and what Jesus Christ did for each of us upon the cross. Father, I pray this morning for each person who is here or may hear this, Father, this tape. I pray, Father, that they might know that You love them, that You don't want to condemn them, but to save them. You say, for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. Father, we need a Savior. We need someone in this life to guide and direct and lead us. And we certainly need someone beyond this life, Father, because we were made for eternity. Father, as we prepare now to celebrate the Lord's Supper, we celebrate Your death, Father, on the cross, that Your body was broken and Your blood was poured out for us as the ultimate expression of love. We pray, Father, that You would remind us as we take this Lord's Supper together that the same power that resurrected Jesus from the dead is available to work in our lives, to do some amazing things, Father, to put marriages back together that seem impossible to put back together, to take lives, Father, that seem like it's too late, but it's never too late. Father, I pray for each person who is here that they would experience Your love in all of its fullness through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.